to the organization that is involved in trying to free Oscar. And we can distribute this, and if you want more information, you know who to contact. Entonces, estamos involucrados con esta iniciativa para liberar Oscar López Rivera, que es un independentista boricua, puertorriqueño, que está en cárcel en Estados Unidos ahora hace 33 años, tiene 71 años y su crimen es de estar con el movimiento y apoyar el movimiento independentista puertorriqueño en contra del colonialismo estadounidense. Y entonces hay una marcha en frente de la ONU este fin de mes y queremos recoger firmas para apoyar esta iniciativa para finalmente dejar en paz y liberar esto preso político. Muchas gracias. Si quieren cualquier información, saben a quién preguntar.
So the signing sheet is circulating. If you agree to the contents of it, if you could please sign and pass it around.
Desafortunadamente, es solo en inglés la letra para firmar, pero hay en español también una explicación de lo que está pasando.
Si alguien quiere ser voluntario para la interpretación, vamos a empezar. Anyone volunteering for the interpretation? We're gonna start. Solo un anuncio. Hay hoy trabajadores de la Telefónica que han ocupado la oficina de Telefónica en la calle comercial de Barcelona por segunda vez en 15 días. Lo hicieron hace dos semanas y dejaron de ocupar porque aceptaron los dueños negociar y hoy han vuelto a hacerlo porque no están contentos. There are workers from Telefónica, the phone operator, who have occupied the main shop of Telefónica in near Plaza Catalunya today. There's action going on. If you are interested to go, it's in support of these workers who have been problems in negotiating with the owners and the managers of the enterprise.
Yo creo que el debate será más en castellano, ahora falta traducción al inglés. Ok, gracias. So, gracias a Katia que va a traducir. Katia is going to translate. Thank you. Bueno, vamos a empezar. Si hay alguna pregunta, ¿es de ahí any question? Preguntas para la sesión de la mañana. Ok.
Thank you. I have some specific questions to Limaflo and Biomed. I would like to know some specific information about how you are organized in your organization. I mean, if there's a general assembly and if you are divided in working groups for doing specific things and how do you decide things, and even if there does exist a self-income for the workers that of course work in Limaflo and Biomed, and how do you decide to redistribute it in all the organization and for the workers? And at the end, because I understood that both of you are trying to be legalized in some way, And I would like to know, on your experience, what are the limits, but also the potentialities of being like a squatted working place? And so, basing on these limits and potentials, why are you trying to be legalized, and in which way? So that's it.
All right. I am part of the Solidarity Initiative. This is a group of very dedicated people who meet with the workers at least once a week on a Solidarity Assembly, as we call it. It is the second most important assembly in the Biome project. The first most important assembly is the Workers' Assembly. They are the ones who take the final decisions. They are the ones who have the control of the project. We, the Solidarity people, we are there to accompany the struggle. We are there to help, and we always respect the decisions of the workers in the end. But there is a great symbiosis. That doesn't mean that the workers do not take into account what the Solidarity people say. Now we have three big areas of activity. One is the economic activity, which is very important because we have to make some kind of income. Otherwise, there's no reason, there's no use for this project. The Solidarity Initiative helps mainly with making connections, trying to build the distribution network, and trying to promote both the struggle and the product. And for example, it was really important when we were developing the products, when we were deciding what to produce. And the other aspect of the struggle is the political aspect. And there the Solidarity Assembly is very, very important. It's the one that organizes the participation in the marches, the campaigns, the great part of the contact with media, both within Greece and outside Greece, is made by the Solidarity Assembly. But gradually, you can see that the workers are taking more and more of these responsibilities in their own hands. This is a case that the workers, when they started this struggle, they didn't have many skills because they never learned them apart from producing what they were producing. And little by little, they're acquiring more skills. 2 years ago, there was only one person out of the workers who could speak in public. The rest of them, they were afraid of cameras and shy, etc. Now there are at least 6 people. So the Solidarity Assembly has also this task of making sure that the Workers' Assembly gets more skills into its own hands, into their own hands gradually. Regarding the income, the sale of the products, of the cleaning products right now, creates a bit of money, which is distributed to the people who work in the factory, according to the time that they spend there, not according to the job that they do. The interesting thing is that the cooperative of the workers was enhanced, was improved by adding 4 new workers there for things that the workers that were already there had no skills or they could not do. And these 4 new workers, 4 members of the cooperative, were previously members of the Solidarity Initiative. And they're there basically because there was no one within the Workers' Assembly who could do the accounting, who could organize the distribution and do the sales, let's say, because it's not exactly sales. And we also have one person now that is doing the international communication, international sales. Before that, the Solidarity Assembly used to do this. So they get very little money. Right now, they earn no more than 300 or 350 euros per month. This is very little money, especially for people who have families. What we're trying to do is legalize the activity, of course. This has been a source of conflict within the wider solidarity movement, with VioMed. There were certain parts of the solidarity movement that thought that it would be ideologically more pure to remain illegal. The problem is that the workers never said that they want to remain illegal. It was just an idea that part of the solidarity movement, especially the ones tied to a certain strand of anarchism, that what they thought the movement should be like. So there was a conflict, and many people left, and they denounced VioMed as sold off to the system, etc. But the workers, since the very start, said that we want not only to become our activity becomes legal, but also that there can be a legal framework that permits many VioMeds. And this is not institutionalization of the struggle, but it is that the law should respect, should ratify what the struggle has created. It's a different conception of creating a law that will create a social reality. No, first you create a social reality, and first you oblige the law to recognize the social reality. Of course there are limits to this, because the legal system is based on the principles of private property, and the VioMed project goes against these principles. So there cannot be a satisfactory legal framework that could be 100% compatible with what the workers do. There will always be an illegal or semi-legal part to our struggle. We just need a law that we would at least leave us alone to do what we do without any repression, but not a law that would describe 100% what we're doing. And especially the problem with the law is that when a company goes bankrupt, there is a long list of creditors who are to be satisfied when the bankrupt company is liquidated or it generates any kind of money. And there is a hierarchy. First goes the state. The failed company owed a lot of money to the inland revenue, in taxes, a lot of money to the social security, in workers' security, insurance, and also a lot of money to the banks, a lot of money to raw materials providers, and of course a lot of money to the workers. So when we are saying that the workers should have absolute priority, and the first thing is to satisfy the workers and ensure the productive continuation, and let all the rest of the people who are owed money die, we don't care, there is a problem with the law there. So that's what the political struggle is for. The political struggle is for convincing society that the most important thing is people's subsistence and the capacity of society to keep producing in its own terms, over the interests of anyone else. That's what we are trying to convince through our political strategy. That's it.
So I'm going to try to speak in English. It's curious, but a lot of stuff that they'll say are also in the remark, a lot of dynamic and other stuff. We are organizing an assembly, so every week we meet and we organize the work, and if we have time, we also speak about political strategy.
said. The idea is in future when the work activity that now is only experimentation became strong and well organized to involve people of the territory to participate to some assembly to define the kind of work and the way to work, especially to control the environmental impact of the activity. But as already said, when we enter in the factory, we invest only our work and not capital or our salvage. So the product of our work is shared based on the time of work that people put in the activity for a part, and the other part is used to make the investment to develop the activity, to buy machinery or other stuff we need. Maybe in future we are thinking to consider also the cognitive aspect of work, so people that got some responsibility that bring the work home, they're gonna take maybe more, I don't know, but not so much more, just considering the time of work, always considering time of work, because what we find that there are people that they just want some do something and stop, and people that spend time also rewriting at home outside the time of, and we want evaluate also that work because it is useful for the development of the project. So we have to find a way to consider also the cognitive aspect of the work that is not always during the working time. But it's just a thinking, we are just starting to think of it. Because at the moment we are too engaged to develop the production. The organization is assembly, and after we split the working group for the different activity which compose the project. The problem of the legalization is central, because we need to be legalized, because otherwise we can have an insurance, we can have a contract. So for workers that fight to improve the contract, to got a good insurance, to once they get the management of the factory, we think that we should improve the condition of the normal. We should improve the condition of the contract, but we need a legal structure to get this condition. Of course, this kind of stuff produces some problematic, because you enter in a legal system and you are a juridic figure that has to move within certain rules. And we have to deal with a market that is hegemonic and try to take over us in an indirect way. So we think that with the political strategy, we can try to avoid this thing. So we call this autogestione conflittuale, self-managed, conflictual self-management. That this means that we are not outside of the system. We are not a happy island outside the system, but we are within the system and we fight in the system. So we are part of a larger front of struggle, worker struggle. So we participate to the strike, or that thing seems maybe silly or obviously, but it's not like this, because when you self-manage a factory, you became a kind of the owner of the factory. So if you do a strike, you are going against your interest, if we extend this kind of thing, no? So you have to be, you have to develop the discussion, the political discussion, because maybe there's people that say in the assembly that say no, we should keep working because we have to finish this stuff. We should not go into the to that manifestation because we have to finish that stuff. So we have to create a political discussion, a political narrative that show to everybody and create consensus to participate, because that participation is linked with the success of the experience. Because once you lose this kind of political dimension, this kind of conflict, is the day that you are done. Because or you enter in the market like another company, and you have to deal with the competition and stuff like this, or you lose your strength and you fail and you close. So the legalization is a way, of course, to as such as Theo said, to have a better condition of work from one place, and the other place is to create a framework to expand, to multiply the experience, to say to other people that are put outside from the work, from our owner that moved the factory abroad or other place, that don't stay home. Self-manager, say, auto-organize yourself and take an empty factory and start to produce, because the law allows you to do it. So if you arrive to get a legalization, we can spread this message and we can involve people to do the same. So and say that is a real way to work in self-management. In that case, yeah, we can create network, and we can create a real form of counter power.
Okay, tenemos una intervención de José Luis y luego la mano de Joel y André.
Yo solo voy a decir algo muy concreto, que es que el tema de la legalización pone sobre la mesa también los términos de qué legalización y en qué forma de figura jurídica. Esto lo digo ya como jurista. O sea, el tema de la legalización pone sobre la mesa también la lucha por el derecho y por la conformación del derecho, por el tipo de derecho que se quiere y cómo está estructurado. Porque como ha dicho Gorka, por ejemplo, la estructura jurídica de las cooperativas en España es distinta a la estructura jurídica de las cooperativas en Argentina. Permite mucho más trabajo asalariado, implica también unas obligaciones de contabilidad mucho más fuertes que en cualquier otra estructura legal y de las que se fomenta para el emprendimiento. Y además implica otra serie de cosas, porque hay que pensar que en Argentina están teniendo la discusión ahora de que se quiere exportar un modelo español, que es el de las sociedades laborales, a Argentina para que las recuperadas se legalicen como sociedades laborales. Las sociedades laborales españolas son sociedades de capital, no son sociedades de trabajo. Si una cooperativa es una sociedad de trabajo, porque en el fondo, legalmente, las personas que trabajan en la cooperativa tienen cada uno un voto. Sin embargo, en las sociedades laborales, el voto va en función del capital aportado. Aunque obligatoriamente más del 50% del capital tiene que estar en manos de personas que son socias y a la vez trabajadores. Es decir, que hay también una pugna y una quiebra en torno a cómo se estructura legalmente eso, e implica también lucha social para poner en la mesa leyes de quiebra, para ver cómo se construye una ley concursal que sea favorable a las recuperaciones, etc.
Vamos a las tres preguntas, está Miguel también, entonces pasaría Joel, André, Miguel, y luego intervenciones de Fabio y bueno, las respuestas que queráis.
Gracias para todas las intervenciones,
There's a subject that we are not really talking about in different conferences, actually, and I would like to hear more about. I would like to hear about the feminist experience in your organization, so maybe more women if you're identified to this question. So if there is any dynamic of power or in the division of work or in the assemblies, or if there is not really this question in your organization, but you see a difference between what you are experiencing actually and what you were experiencing before you tried those organizations. So maybe talk a bit about that.
¿Alguien necesita castellano? Sí, están Lucho y...
Yeah, my question is... it's about Greece, and I would like to know how much this example of Wiome is or can be an example for a lot of different factories, or not only factories, but can be used as a model in Greece to organize the life in a different way, because you have the crisis or the neoliberal assault since many, many years. So it's not just a practical thing, how to organize things, but also imaginable thing. It's like to create a different society in a different way, self-management, self-organized. And I'm wondering, because you talk about this is the only factory in Greece, I know that there are some other collectives, like in Crete, or they have some self-organized clinics, but how is it possible that this can spread very far within society? And I think it might be a good opportunity right now in Greece because of the changes. And the last question is, how much is this affected now by the new government, Syriza, we have since a few months?
Well, my question is for all of you, all the experiences, even including the rural ones, because I think what it's always involved in the self-management of work and the self-management of social centers and even houses is a conflict between autonomy and the external law, heteronomy. Which means that what kind of internal laws, internal norms, internal mechanisms and procedures to regulate yourselves as a collective are important, and which ones are in contradiction with external regulations, with external law. So I think in the case of the Integral Cooperative, Catalan Integral Cooperative, they mentioned that they are trying to use the law in a creative way to find like loopholes where to hide themselves. So they legalize some parts, but they don't legalize other parts. But then, once you have internal conflicts, and for example, if someone from inside the collective is not happy with any issue, it's very likely that he or she is going to go into court to claim for his money, for his rights, or whatever, for example. And this can happen in most of the situations. So my question is, what kind of norms are really alternative, important for you? What is your own legality that is important to keep these experiences alive? And what kind of conflicts or contradictions have you experienced in contrast to the external law? So you can provide some examples that can be useful. Thank you.
Okay, we have two questions for the broad experiences, and one specific for Greece that Andre made. ¿Quieres contestar? No, to answer the one Andre made, and then take opportunity to look on the feminist and gender perspective and Miguel's question, and then pass the micro around. Even for the rural experience, it probably is relevant. The other two questions.
Regarding the issue of feminism, the recuperated workplaces have some specific characteristics. One characteristic that is a great obstacle many times is that they inherit the characteristics of the previous failed company. So many times what they produce, where they produce it, how they produce it, and also the composition of the workforce are things that they have very little control over. Now, when we're talking about industrial working class, what springs to mind is immediately male. Okay. That's the stereotypic working class. I don't think that this is what the composition of the working class today. I think that working class is a useful concept, but it's not what it used to be 100 years ago. Within the original group of workers, there were no women, and because most of the women worked in the administrative part, in 99% of the cases, including Argentina, where there have been recuperated workplaces, the administrative part of the company, being more qualified, it being easier to find work outside in the labor market, and being also closer to the boss, they don't participate in the recuperation, they go. So there were 40 men when they started the recuperation. Of course, the Solidarity Assembly is a different case. They have people who are dedicated, most of them are like militants, activists. So you have the composition that's pretty much equal, and you have many women being at the forefront of the Solidarity Assembly. Exactly because there you don't have the pre-selection that is made by the circumstances. And also in the new acquisitions, the new workers that came to the cooperative, two of them are women and two of them are men out of the four. So now you have two women within the cooperative. So within the conditions that we have inherited from the previous company, this is a factor today, the gender issue. Regarding the other question, that was, we can write a book about it, both regarding the Viomeras as an example and the relation with the new government. They're very interrelated.